For those of you whom I don't know, and I think that's very few at this point, I'm Steve Slick. I'm the director of the Intelligence Studies Project here. So I'll steal this opportunity just to give you a couple of program notes. I want to thank everybody. I see a lot of familiar faces who attended our conference at the end of March on intelligence in American society. It was terrifically successful from our point of view. We've got a lot of positive feedback, including from our guests from the White House who were here. So thanks very much for making that a success. Looking forward, we're not quite done. We've had a hectic pace this spring, and this is an important event today. But we're not finished. We'll have one more before the end of the semester, and that's on April 29th. We're going to be hosting on campus Michael Hayden. General Hayden, as most of you know, is the former director of NSA and director of the CIA and the first principal deputy director of national intelligence. And he's P. Diddy. The community. And a terrific public servant intelligence officer and a great friend of ours. And so he's coming to Austin. And what we're going to do is we're going to have an event at 3:30 in the afternoon over at the AT&T Conference Center. Somebody else in here will know the exact room number, but you can find it.
I think it's 203.
Is it 203? Is that right, Ann?
No, it's...
We switched it every hour, sir.
I think it's on 106. On the first floor.
Like I said, somewhere in the AT&T conference room, my cable. So anyway, you're all invited to that, but I wouldn't dally on this because it's going to be a room about this size, and you'll need to be reserved and confirmed to attend. So watch for that on our site, and that will round out. So today, we're terrifically privileged to host another distinguished speaker in our intelligence studies series. And today's guest is the chairman of the National Intelligence Council, Greg Treverton. Dr. Treverton is a truly distinguished practitioner. He'd served previously in the mid-80s at the National Intelligence Council as the vice chairman. In the intervening years, he served in a number of management leadership positions at the Rand Corporation. He served even more broadly in government and in the intelligence and security fields, including as a member of the first Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, growing out of the Church Committee hearings in the mid-70s. He also served as a policy official in the National Security Council. He has written extensively, monographs, different art forms, including two books, one on the adaptations we've made in the last 10 or 15 years in our community to deal with the massive amounts of information that are available, and another, which he authored just before the 9/11 attacks, and then addressing after that in the book the restructuring of the community to deal with terrorism. So what I've asked Dr. Treverton to do today, and we can take this wherever you all would like, would be to tell us a little bit about the work of the National Intelligence Council. It's a unique organization within our intelligence community for lots of reasons that he'll explain. He could also say a word about the state of intelligence analysis. Although he denied it in a meeting with our students earlier today, he's as close as we come to a senior official in our community who's really responsible for the state of the analytic profession, analytic tradecraft, the quality of what we're doing, what we're writing on. So we can get into that a little bit with him. But most of the time I think we'll spend on what's one of the NIST's best known and most fascinating projects. This is the Global Trends, Global Futures Project. Originally started in 1997. We're now, I think, approaching the sixth edition of this volume. I carry the last published one around with me. This is the 2030 Global Trends Report. The next one will come out, I understand, or at least be briefed to the candidates in the fall as they contemplate the prospect of leading our country. And so it will address the next 5-year stretch. I did notice as I was looking through through this volume that the ambitions of this series have changed a little bit. I think it started out with global futures and alternative worlds, which sounds very certain, but was eventually dialed back to now what are global trends. So we're not exactly anticipating what's going to happen, but describe which way the world's headed. So anyway, with that, please join me in welcoming Dr. Treverton.
thanks. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's always fun to come to Austin to see old friends. Bob Evans and I were just talking about how long we've known each other, which is a stunningly long time, since the mid-70s when I was an infant and he was a teenager. In any case, it's always great to be here and to talk about the NIC. What I thought I would do, as Steve said, is talk a bit about the NIC, where it is. I think everybody should know chapter and verse about the National Intelligence Council, the NIC, but maybe not everybody does. So I will say a word about where it sits and what we do, and then move forward, as Steve said, to talking about giving you a little preview of both how we do the global trends work and a little preview of how we're coming out as we look 20 years into the future and try and also dial back and think about the next 5 years. You can get anybody in Washington, I think, still bet that the NIC is a CIA organization. It hasn't been a CIA organization in 40 years, but time goes slowly in Washington in some respects. We've always been an interagency intelligence analytic group, working first for the Director of Central Intelligence in his capacity as DCI, not Director of CIA, and now we work for the Director of National Intelligence. Everything we do is done really on an interagency basis. So we are composed of national intelligence officers and deputies organized like the State Department, regionally and functionally. All the NIOs come from outside government, from other intelligence agencies. It's a wonderful set of people. Virtually all the deputies come from another intelligence service, but a wide range. I have a deputy from the Secret Service, an analyst from NYPD, so it's a terrific group of people. The big change is, Steve said I was vice chairman of the NIC in the Clinton administration in the mid-90s, so it's taken me a long time to rise, visibly a slow riser. The big change for me is in those days we were most identified with our signature product, which is called the National Intelligence Estimate. We mostly did, not necessarily national intelligence estimates, but more strategic work. Work that tried to reach a little further ahead in time, that tried to show connections across issues, that tried to set issues in their context. But that's what I care about. That's the style of analysis that interests me the most. The big change, though, now is with the DNI, we are very deeply in the current intelligence support business. We are the providers of intelligence support to the Principals Committee, senior policy-making body in the executive branch and foreign policy, principals in all of the agencies, and also, more importantly, deputies. We provide them with day-to-day intelligence support. And the deputies really are the sort of pivotal committee. They tee issues up, they discuss issues, they look at alternatives. They meet, maybe way too often, but they meet every day about something, every Saturday, several times Sundays, and so for my national intelligence officers who are in hot accounts, Ukraine, Russia, Middle East, ISIL, counter-terror, they literally can spend all of their lives preparing for, going to, and following up on White House meetings. So what happens, last year, for instance, we did about 700 pieces of paper. About 400 of those were signed memorandums from a national intelligence officer to Susan Rice, the national security advisor, the deputy, or another senior national security council official, something that came more or less directly out of the deputies committee. Can you tell us more about this? Can you do something? Can you help enlighten us about this? Now, some of those are pretty immediately tactical, but not all of them are. Some of them rise to a bit more strategic. They'll come back to us and say, okay, if we do X, how will Putin respond? Or how will it affect his entourage? Those are just the kind of questions that I think intelligence and policy should be interacting over. But for me, the challenge, when I was at the NIC in the 90s, we kept asking ourselves, are we relevant? Now we don't worry about that. We're up to our eyeballs in relevance. Now we ask ourselves, are we strategic? So my challenge every day is to try and find ways for us to be a bit more strategic, kind of raise the sights a bit of our policy counterparts, to give them context, to give them a bit of a framework. And that's, if you can imagine, kind of uphill battle given the tyranny of the immediate. We're 100 analysts, sometimes say my boss, Jim Clapper, Director of National Intelligence, how come it is that 100 of us do for you what John Brennan, the CIA director, has 3,000 people to do? This seems unfair, but it is our work, and it doesn't mean we're very much in the middle of things. It's a great place when I, on good days, and most days are good, I think that given our size, given competence, given the fact that we're, for historical reasons, all crammed together in the CIA headquarters, contributing to the sense that we must be a CIA organization, but aren't, I think that if any intellectual institution either have been associated with inside government and the academy has the chance of working successfully across the divides that always frustrates economics, politics, regions, technology, it's us. We're big enough to have capacity, but not so big that we can have stovepipes. We talk to each other. And one of the things I'll remember most and best about the Senate of the NIC is we had a farewell party, a series of long farewell parties for national intelligence officers who've been there a long time. And at one of this seemingly endless stream of farewells, he said that the thing he would remember best about the NIC were peer reviews. Now, mostly people often think of peer reviews as sort of difficult occasions. But we do peer reviews seriously. Every Tuesday morning, we'll look at terms of reference, we'll look at a draft product, and it really is a wonderful conversation. Because you get this set of people, all of whom are in the same business as you. They're trying to make intellectual products, help policymakers better. But they come at it from very different backgrounds, very different specialties in terms of issues. It really is a wonderful conversation. I'm happy to talk more about our current support work, but I did want to give you a little bit of a flavor for our other signature product, which is the Global Trends series that Steve mentioned. I didn't get to do Global Trends. I was left to make before it. We did it 20 years ago. But I did have play some role in conceiving the idea. And there were two parts of the conception that I think have turned out to work very well. One was, if you're trying to look further than a year ahead, none of that classified stuff on your screen helps much. If you're gonna try and look more than a year ahead, you need to be out there reading, talking to people, meeting with the experts. So we will, by the time we do the next Global Trends, which should in the series be Global Trends 2035, but won't be. I'm not gonna put a year on this one. So if you have a good idea, it's got to be Global Trends something. But so if you have an idea of what it should be Global Trends what, I welcome the end of the title. But it isn't going to be 2035. It's sort of increasingly fictitious. In any case, what's happened since we do this every 4 years looking out, 20 years, time horizon has gotten longer and longer and longer. And that does do some brutality to the reality and capability of the piece. In any case, we will. But it does mean we have to reach out, and that's the way we do our work in general. I want the NIC to be the most transparent, the most reaching out, the most engaged with the academy of any piece of the intelligence community, and Global Trends assures that we are. By the time we publish this one, we will have traveled to something like 35 countries. We will have touched in one way or another through conferences, focus groups, or some other way, about 2,000 people. So it really is a wonderful, wonderful opportunity for us to reach out. This time we're trying also to reach beyond the usual think tank and policymaker circles. We'll talk to them for sure. But we've been trying to reach women's groups. We had a good session with entrepreneurs in Bangalore. We had a focus group with students in Mexico City. We've been trying to get to the more social, societal underpinnings of the big trends we're looking at. The second insight I had as a Washingtonian was that it had to be unclassified. It had to be unclassified for all sorts of reasons, but it had to be unclassified for one important reason, and that was if we were ever going to get our policy counterparts, particularly senior policy officials, to pay attention, the only way that would happen would be if they read about it in the press. If we took this document to them, they would say, oh, thank you very much, this looks terrific, I'll read it when I have a chance. That chance never would come. But if they see something about it in the press, then they'll turn to their special assistants and say, what the devil is Nick up to? What are they doing? And that's actually worked remarkably well. It's also become a bit of a brand that people know about, and it's well known, pretty well known around the world. So in that sense, it's been gratifying to see. Let me give you just a little bit of a flavor, and I'm eager, as Steve said, to take this conversation in whatever direction is of most interest to you. But let me give you just a quick run through of what the 20-year perspective, things we're focusing on in 20 years, and then pull back to a 5-year perspective and give you a flavor for that. When you think about the 20-year longer perspective, I think we're going to look at probably 5 or 6 major trends. Not always, I think, will surprise you. Maybe none of them will. The first really is the increasing empowerment of individuals and small groups. And the global trends that Steve was good enough to hold up. We focused a lot on the transfer of power toward Asia, the shift of power toward Asia. That continues. So does the declining power of Europe. But in this one, we're going to focus on the increasing empowerment of individuals and small groups. That's obvious in the case of terrorists, but we also know that wayward French bankers have a big effect on the financial system. And when you think about the fact that the Gates Foundation spends more money on health in Africa than the World Health Organization, you got to realize that single individuals make a lot of difference in this world, and probably increasingly so. The implication we'll draw from that, I think, is that for that reason and for some others, the challenge of organizing coalitions to deal with global commons problems will get harder. I think our conclusion will be that organizing coalitions on global commons problems that are truly shared, like pandemics, that'll probably be possible, but on other issues, including climate change, I dare say, it will continue to be difficult to organize those coalitions to deal with those global commons problems. Second on this list, again, this isn't a surprise, I think we and me, like us other people, think there have been significant structural changes in the international economy, and we imagine a period of slower growth going forward than we've been accustomed to in the last couple of decades. That has all sorts of implications. We know that slower economic growth makes almost every problem harder to solve. It means that convergence between rich economies and poor will be slower. It means that inequalities, both within societies and across them, will grow. That's a characteristic of the future we see. Third on this list is really confrontations and values. And here the one that struck me most recently is that something I've taken to call the prosperity presumption. We Americans hold very deeply, it seems to me, almost subconsciously, the view that prosperity is good in all sorts of ways. It makes people happier, it makes them more likely to be democratic, less likely to fight each other. It's pretty deeply buried in our approach to the world. But then we bump into ISIL, who cares about none of that, has no interest in prosperity whatsoever. So that's a stark form of the values conflict we'll see in front of us. More subtle ones will be that reflected in dealings with, say, China over international economic and other international institutions, where they plainly feel that they've grown into a world where the international institutions were made in America, or at least made in the West, and they want to reshape them or replace them with institutions more to their own liking. Fourth on this list is technology. Here I suspect we will focus on two. One will be artificial intelligence, and the other will be bio. I used to think that artificial intelligence was like that old line about Brazil. Remember, I said about Brazil that Brazil was the country of the future and always would be. I used to think that artificial intelligence was the technology of the future and always would be. But now I think it's here, and so we'll explore it in some detail. There, I think the proximate implication is that a lot of disruption in job markets around the world, including the United States. You've probably seen the British study that suggests that half of American jobs are vulnerable to being automated in all or in part in the next couple of decades. And that turns out to include lots of jobs that we think of as professional. It turns out to be a lot easier to help a computer learn how to do accounting than it is to help a computer learn how to give a good massage. So jobs at risk include ones we typically think of as more professional as well. Next on this list would be relations between states and their citizens. Here I'm not sure I've kind of got my mind entirely around this, but there seems to be an increasing disconnect that takes different manifestations in different places, but an increasing disconnect between states and their citizens. We see it, obviously, in our own country, but it takes, we see it a lot in Europe, where it takes a somewhat different form. So thinking through the implications of that changing, if not disconnecting, relationship between citizens and their governments is, I think, a theme we'll pursue in lots of different places across the globe. The last on my list for this 20-year look will be the changing nature of warfare. Here, too, I have as many questions as answers, but it does seem to me, if you think about, certainly the human race is no stranger to brutality, but the kind of brutality reflected by ISIL is at least very notable. So you put together increasing brutality with the increasing difficulty, almost impossibility, of separating combatants from non-combatants. Again, a trend that's been going on for a long time, but is starkly visible in the Middle East in the terrorism context. With the prospect that all of the technologies that we will have, from drones to nano to other things, our adversaries will have as well, seems to me to amount to a major change in the nature of warfare. Maybe here the best precursor is the conflict between Israel and Hezbollah in 2006, but we see other echoes of this change in lots of places, particularly these days in the Middle East. Well, that's my 20-year perspective, a starter set, things we're working on. One of the things I wanted to do in this version of Global Trends is pull back from 20 years, which may not be 20 years, in any case, more likely to be 10 years, right? But pull back to more a five-year look. When I came to the NIC a year and a half ago, I had the impression that the National Intelligence Officers all thought Global Trends was a great thing to do, but didn't have much to do with them. So I wanted the NIOs to take ownership. So pulling back to a five-year time horizon is closer to the horizon that their policy counterparts might be a little interested in. Now, I have to say, at this point in the administration, the time horizon of our policy colleagues is mostly measured in days, months or years. But as we think about the next administration trying to lay that basis for a five-year future, at least the administrations at their beginnings have a time horizon that extends for 4 years and for five. So trying to think about a five-year time horizon is important. What strikes me about the five-year time horizon is that most of the things that are going to be important in the next 5 years are already with us. So we're asking how might those develop or change or move over the next 5 years. So let me start with what I think of as the certainties of the next 5 years. One certainty is the Middle East will continue to be, in technical intelligence terms, a mess. All of the trends are going in the wrong direction, and while I, as a personal matter, I'm not sure my analysts agree, I think that ISIL has rather peaked, but it's going to morph into something else. So we're going to continue, it seems to me, to see conflict at various levels and various forms. This Middle East is the most complicated international security problem I've ever seen. I determined earlier in my career that I would steadfastly avoid working on the Middle East. That's over. It was a good determination, I now realize, but it's over. I'm up to my eyeballs in it. But it is the most complicated, where the arrows go in so many different directions. enemies of your enemies are enemies one day, friends the next. Interpenetrations among the various groups is, puts a lie to lots of the policy debates we have in Washington, and it will continue. So the question there, I think, is how much is contained in the Middle East and how much it spills out. Even if I'm right about ISIL and it's on its way down, we saw from Al-Shabaab earlier, you see now, it got more violent the less territory it controlled, and that would be the case for ISIL as well. Second certainty is that Europe will continue to be beset by both the North, the East, and the South. They'll continue to have the migration problem, which will continue then to fuel right-wing populist movements in Europe. Unlikely that those will take power, but they will add an edge difficulty in European politics. We see a big disconnect between the main European institutions, the EU in particular, and the challenges they face. We had an interesting sort of philosophical conversation recently among the deputies about, they were talking about alliances and partnerships, and the debate turned on, is the European Union a hindrance or a help? Now, purely philosophical, because we don't get to choose, it's up to Europeans to decide, and we'll deal with it no matter what. But there is a big disconnect between that institution, which was created entirely by economics, open borders, and now Europe finds itself with a major security challenge for which the Union is at least badly suited, and maybe in some instances a kind of handicap. Russia's precise course is less certain, but that Russia will continue to be a meddler. There the question for me is, since Putin is so isolated, I don't think he's unstrategic, but there seems to be a risk that he will miscalculate, make a mistake, do something in an Article 5 country that would take us into a very different world. Russia is a fascinating policy problem because everything that Putin's doing is hastening Russia's demise, but not yet. It's a longer-term challenge. In the long run, we'll worry, my guess is, much more about a weak Russia than about a strong Russia, but that's not now. In the long run, as they say, we're all dead. We have to get through the next few years dealing with Mr. Putin. Third on the certainty list is the collapse in commodity prices and the effect that's going to have, part of the reason why we're expecting slower economic growth. It also means that countries that were successful at pulling people out of poverty, not just China, but also Brazil, are going to see their citizens fall back into poverty. Turns out to be hard enough to pull people out of poverty, maybe harder still to deal with their expectations once they're pulled out of poverty, particularly falling back in. On the uncertainties, two big ones, even over the next 5 years. One is China, and the other is us. I don't get to say much about us because I'm an intelligence officer, not a policy person, so I leave that as an exercise for you all to think about. But no surprise, it seems to me the big uncertainties about even the next 5 years are about the two biggest powers in the system. For China, it's bumps ahead in the road for China. The question how big those bumps will be, how successful they will be at overcoming them. That's, I think, a question that some of my colleagues would say is maybe a little longer than 5 years, but that's not my view. I think the things we see now are already the beginnings of what could amount to a really serious set of bumps in the road for China. As I said, I'll leave us as an exercise. You can work through that one, but certainly a lot of the future of the international system does depend on us. It's always been a big gap in the practice of intelligence that now we get to talk about the United States some, but the focus has always been on those folks over there. Well, that was always epistemological nonsense because you can't understand them without understanding something about us. And the more we care about an issue, the more we matter to the outcome. Maybe the case that during the Cold War, focusing on them was okay, but friend and mentor Harold Brown, the former defense secretary, testified before Congress long ago about the U.S.-Soviet nuclear competition. He said, when we build nuclear weapons, they build. When we stop, they build. The point was, while we hoped to influence Soviet decisions, we didn't have a lot of confidence that we would, and so therefore, trying to understand them on their own terms may have made sense. Complete nonsense now when you think about terrorists who are entirely adapting to us, entirely looking for our seams and defenses, opportunities, and vulnerabilities. Just a couple of others. People talk about black swans. I think technically black swans can't be imagined. So we talk, where's Adam? My colleague, he gets credit for this. We refer to Appaloosa swans, or sometimes gray swans. But I like Appaloosa better, and since we're in horse country, it's probably a better term here in Texas as well. So a couple of Appaloosa swans. One is in tech. There I mentioned, again, the artificial intelligence piece of it. I didn't talk about bio, but in the period when we're seeing CRISPR, Cas9 with us, the things that might happen even in a 5-year time horizon on the biotech front are really have the potential to be enormously good, and there are also some big things to worry about in that set of issues. In all my time at Cambridge, Massachusetts, I've never been to the Quantum Media Lab. I was there in the fall, and it was wonderful. I recommend it to anybody. So it's terrific. But the watchword that I took away from that was, bio is today where IT was 25 years ago. Poised advances that will be dramatic. Now, CRISPR may have misled us a little bit, but great things are out there. Exactly what those things are, some are longer term than others, but it is going to be moving very fast. My sense is that it'll have, on the positive sense, lots of positive, but that even the positives are likely to increase inequality. So all those life lengthening and life enhancing biological, biomedical advances are going to come first to rich people in rich countries, and then later to poor people in poorer countries. So there will be some increasing inequality, powerful, and on the downside, I can imagine we've started to worry a bit about weapons of mass destruction that are more usable rather than less, and not immediately, but it's possible to imagine over a 5+, maybe more, this is more of a 20-year time horizon, possible to imagine bio weapons that were targeted on a particular ethnic group, even on a particular individual. Only talk about the downside. It's always said of intelligence officers that when they see flowers, they think of coffins. I don't want to do that, but it is something to worry about. Finally, let me just conclude with some of the things that might happen even on a 5-year time horizon. These are the ones that are on most people's list, but we're going to give you two. Even on a 5-year time horizon, it's possible to imagine, and we should pay some attention to, a collapse of an important state, collapse or serious difficulties of an important state. That I think is even on the 5-year time horizon, if you look at some of the states in the Middle East, Jordan, Saudi Arabia. And another obvious one is also unfortunately possible to imagine a nuclear weapon being used in anger in the next 5-year period. Now I have committed the intelligence analysts fault of seeing coffins. But those are some of the things that we're paying attention to. And when I look back at the set of global trends, last year was 2015, as you know. And so some people said, there was a global trends 2015 done in 2000. How'd they do? And the answers were mostly pretty good. But what struck me in reading that 2015, global trends 2015, was in 2000, most thinking about the future of globalization was pretty rosy. Sure, we understood there was an underside, the terrorists, but it was pretty rosy. And so probably, at least in my reading, Global Trends 2015 is a station future. And that's maybe cautious that this time around, I want to make sure in the next global trends, we pay attention to those futures that are not necessarily very likely, or we don't know how likely they are, but would be very consequential if they happen. In general, I think intelligence analysis often pay too much attention to probability, which is important, but we care equally about consequence for those highly consequential possibilities that maybe aren't very likely, but we don't know how likely they are, obviously deserve a place in the analysis. Steve, let me stop there and hope that I said something worth asking about or commenting.
That was terrific. Thank you. So I'll exercise the question. Let me just kick this off and we'll let you moderate the Q's and A's. You may recognize this question as I asked you the question. You gave me a good answer, but not everything I needed to hear. So this is a question that I'll
hope you better this time around.
I've been thinking about this for 7 months. Okay. Now this concerns the craft of intelligence analysis, especially the intelligence analysis. And you've written on this, you shape your national intelligence for the information age. And it's the question of massive volume of data and the business of mining that for timely, accurate, insightful intelligence. And you told me up in Washington that you thought we were doing okay on this, that we had an approach. My sense is that many of the answers to questions we have is somewhere out there in open sources, maybe on social networks, and that we don't yet have a tradecraft that allows us to access that, make sense of it, filter the useful from the less useful, and I think it's less of a challenge. I think it's actually an opportunity for our society given our technological track record. Can you talk a little bit more about how are we going to take advantage of all this stuff that's out there?
Yeah. That's a great question. I think I'd repeat that we're not doing badly at it. Let me leave aside the do you get access to the data? That's another huge debate. But assuming that just that there's lots of data out there that possibly you could get access to and use, there I think progress is going pretty fast at making use of it. But you know, think about social media is still huge volumes, huge unreliability. And so the processing of social media data probably easier for private sector, where they can do searches around their product name or their competitors' product names, look for adjectives, do some content analysis. Harder for us if we're trying to pick up something that will tip us about a set of developments out there. But I think we're getting better at it. We're still a little uncoordinated at it. The different agencies are working on it themselves. I have a feeling that we all have the same set of discovery about different tools. We probably pay for them over and over again, which I wouldn't like. I'd like to have some clearinghouse. I'm trying to push for using the Open Source Center as the sort of clearinghouse for most of the data tools. But there's an awful lot of good stuff out there. We're running in my Africa account a small experiment. We're small, but I want to do a kind of existence theorem. Like if the NIC, small as it is, can make useful use of big data, or even data sets, anybody can. So there what we're doing, not all big data, but we have a data scientist looking at what data's out there on Africa. There's not a huge amount of intelligence data on Africa, but there's a lot of other data. And you know, so far we've found what you'd expect, that you can do a pretty good job with open source data, relatively simple manipulations in predicting disease and predicting hunger. The next step is to see if we can use that data to begin to provide tips. Say to analysts, maybe you should look here, or maybe you should think about this connection that you haven't thought of before. So I think the private sector generally has a more bounded problem than we do, and they also have lots and lots of resources to throw at it. But I think we're not doing too badly. We're going to lag behind them. We're going to depend on them. But we're at least are aware of the need. Various agencies have created new specialties of data scientists, data analysts. That's, as you can imagine, in the first iteration that didn't work so well because they come in, they weren't sure what traditional analysts wanted, traditional analysts weren't sure what they could do, but we're getting better.
Maybe this is a case where an intelligence challenge can come together with one of these trends that you've identified. Artificial intelligence could be the answer.
Yeah, it'll be part, it's gotta be part of the answer for everybody.
Could you elaborate a little bit more on your statement regarding the demise of Russia, or Putin's statement? What's gonna happen, and why do you think that?
Well, demise, I meant mostly, you know, economically and demographically, they're on the short end of the stick. And the collapse in oil prices, coupled with sanctions, has made that worse and worse. But in general, they've done a terrible job in diversifying their economy away from natural resources. That's a waning asset in general. The demographics are against them, are getting smaller. So primarily economics and demographics that, and the fact that they haven't made any significant, serious adjustment. 20 years ago, I guess I would have bet on the Russian kids. As far as I can tell, the kids now have either moved to Brighton Beach or Los Angeles, or kept their heads down and go back and forth to London. Long run prospects for Russia, I think, are pretty dire. But that means long run.
See, this group will have minimal exposure to national intelligence. And can you go back to the 2002 national intelligence estimate on Iraq nuclear?
Oh, do I have to?
Well, all of the media coverage that's in their line, all of that, sort of take people through how something like that's put together,
sure.
What its level of certainty or uncertainty is, and then how. The real problem is people extract bits and pieces for their own policy.
Yeah. Well, good set of questions. I could probably talk till dinner about that, but you probably have dinner plans, so let me not do that. The idea behind national intelligence estimate is to try and do a pretty definitive treatment of a major important issue or set of issues. So take Bob's example, is not one I like especially, but there what would happen is basically agree on kind of what the question was, probably have some conversation with that about that with policy folks, particularly the NSC folks. Is this, have we got the question right? Then we would sit down, peer review on a terms of reference, which the appropriate NIO would be, in this case it would be a couple of NIOs, because it's going to be both probably the weapons of mass destruction NIO, the Middle East NIO, and the terrorism in Ohio. And so they would be the principals in this conversation about terms of reference. Then they would go back to their communities of analysts and talk to them, agree, yeah, we've got the questions right, how are we going to approach this, critically, who's going to draft it, and then the drafting would begin. Then it would come back, once there was a draft, go back peer review at the NIC again, and then it would go into what is euphemistically called coordination. Coordination means all the agencies get a chance to argue about it and see whether they agree or disagree. If they agree, fine. If they disagree, then they will take a footnote. So the estimate will say, State Department, Bureau of Intelligence Research thinks something different. My favorite coordination study. So I was at the NIC before, I had an analytic group, and one of its members was a crotchety CIA officer who didn't fit very well in very rounded pegs of the CIA personnel system. So I was always having to get him out of trouble. But he was a wonderful character, and once wrote a complimentary email to me and the chairman and said, please burn this after you read it. Ruin my reputation. he was once at a coordination session, and somebody, one of the agencies, turned on him and said, why are you here? Who do you represent? And without batting an eyelash, he said, I represent the English language. And so he did. Because as you can imagine, in coordination, the English language is often a casualty of the process. So then once we've done the estimate, then it'll go in front of the National Intelligence Board, which is the heads of all the agencies. It will get approved, changed, modified, Then it gets previewed to the president, and then it gets published more widely. Typically, the key insights will be in the president's statement brief, and they'll have access to the whole estimate. And so, one of the things I did is the key judgments used to be called the key judgments. I decided we call them key insights. I took this from an old book about the New Yorker magazine, where somebody said, observed, Brendan Gill, I said, observed that they call their cartoonists at the New Yorker artists, and sometimes they work. So I think by calling these insights, maybe sometimes they will be. In any case, that's my own. So the part of the trade draft increasingly after the 2002 estimate has been to be very careful about sourcing. The challenge there is that in some ways, if you're doing something that's a little forward-looking, the interesting questions begin where the evidence ends, right? So it's not so much sourcing, it's can you make a compelling argument based on what is the logic train clear? And in that, great sadness about the 2002 estimate, it was probably the best that could have been done at the time. And it wasn't that it was wrong, it turned out to be wrong, but the fact that it was wrong wasn't the main problem. The problem for me was that it was so determinedly, assuredly wrong. It did what we always try to get done, and that is take out all the qualifiers, be clear. Unfortunately, it was pretty clear about the wrong conclusion. At least it should have had an excursion in a box. What's the best case to be made that's along the same doesn't have weapons of mass destruction? It would have changed history, but it would have been a little more, a better intelligence work. The other thing we do with some success is to try and be more careful about words of probability. This is an old issue of intelligence. You know, if I say probably, you may think I mean 55% likely, you may think 80%, right? So trying to be sort of done is equated words of probability with a range. So 60 to 70, can't be too precise, but try to pin down, well, here's what we mean if we say almost certainly, or very likely. I'm not sure that any of our policy counterparts even notice this, but it's at least good for us. Rigorous. Incidentally, Sherman Kent, in some ways the father of modern American intelligence analysis, tried something similar 60 years ago in what was then my predecessor organization called the Office of National Estimates. He said everybody in the office hated the idea. They split into two groups. One group I think he calls the scientists. And they said trying to equate this to probabilities is spurious precision. The other he called the poets, and they said, this whole exercise is so subjective, how can you possibly do this? But nobody liked it.
But the point, I'm reading you, so it's good. The user, the policy people. My experience was they would select the piece of the other. That's their question. I'd take something forward they agreed with, they'd tell me how brilliant I was. And I take something that they didn't agree with, and they Sherman Kent. So it's how the users read these products.
Yeah, absolutely. I never got that. I'm not good at graphics, so I can never do this right. But I always thought that there was sort of a curve for intelligence. Intelligence typically gets sort of better in a linear fashion over time. Right? We think about it more. We may collect more. We may find more. Then I thought, how's that compare with policymaker interests, right? So, at the very beginning, what policymakers want to know is, what is this? Is it an apple and orange? Is it important, not important? And often at that point, intelligence isn't quite good enough to answer that question. And then the intelligence gets better, but at the next phase, what person wants to know is, what should I think, if they're open-minded? And probably at that point, intelligence is really good at saying, this is an apple, not an orange, but not yet good enough to say, here are the implications of that for how you think about the future. And then beyond that, I couldn't make this work, but beyond that, then, it's Bob's proposition. Beyond that, policy people have made up their mind. They're absolutely interested in intelligence, and they agree with it, and absolutely uninterested, They don't, but that's the way the world works. Sir?
In your 5 or 20-year outlook, where do you put things like nuclear proliferation, robotics, cyber warfare, cyber crime, and demographics? The demographics of the world changing very significantly. So where, yeah, how does that fit in your analysis?
Yeah, both, I mean, those are all, I mean, robotics is obviously one of the technologies we're thinking about in the artificial intelligence realm. Lots more autonomous systems that are in front of us. The demographics, I think, is sort of embedded in everything, and we understand it pretty well. I mean, the people that are going to be creating people already here, so we have some sense. Now, if you look backwards, demographic projections are not always as good as you think they would be, given the fact that we're going to make new people already here. But I think we understand that pretty well. We understand the aging problem in the richer countries, understand the remaining sort of youth bulges, potential instability in some of the poorer countries. I think that's pretty well into our judgment, so I wouldn't break it out, I think. On nuclear proliferation, it's a good question, and it'll certainly be there. It has to be. In some ways, again, this is more my personal preference, not something I would say as a representative of NIC or intelligence, but I sometimes think we worry too much about nuclear proliferation and not enough about bio. But that's my sort of, it turns out that nuclear proliferation beyond states to groups we really worry about ain't as easy as it looks. Lots of people have done work on that. So it's not that we don't worry about it, but it's,
I mean, when you talk about demographics, are you able to, I mean, I'm sure you're not able, but you must consider immigration and transfer of large populations that are going on now. How do you deal with that?
Well, it's interesting. If you think about what's going on in Europe, I think this is sort of that social experiment speeded up. We knew that Europe needed people. We knew those people were mostly going to come from the Middle East and North Africa, because that was the only place where there were surplus people. But we expected that to happen over decades, not over weekends or months. So in that sense, what is ultimately probably a good thing for Europe, but it's happening on a time scale that makes it really hard for them to adjust.
Does your work concentrate more on military issues or social issues?
I hope it does all those. Our focus is obviously national security, but national security by broad definition, you can't disregard social issues, just as you can't disregard economic ones. I was having a fascinating conversation with a colleague from MIT the other day, and he said, taking your 20-year look, shouldn't you take the red-blue divide in the United States seriously? And I said, I think I do. I think that mostly is a fact, and maybe not always a bad fact, because it means we have sort of ongoing experiments with some states having different approaches to marijuana, for instance, and others. But he said, no. Shouldn't you take seriously the possibility that even in a 20-year time horizon, the country might literally come apart? Now, I don't think we'll get that far, but it's at least interesting that that's on the minds of people we talk to. It's not something we would necessarily easily come to in the intelligence world, but a good reason why we're out there talking to people that have more zany views than us. Well, not zany, more venturesome. Yes, ma'am.
On the topic of sharing data from intelligence
agencies,
I
yes.
I'm interested in to know if there's concern that presenting different horizons, the 20-year and the 5-year, that there may be a risk of the 20-year horizon sort of getting crowded out by the more immediate concerns of the 5-year horizon. I'm thinking specifically the Middle East, which I agree is kind of a mess, but I think a lot of the mess comes from these 20-year projections, the disconnect between states and their citizens. But in responding to the board, sort of the pack of operational risk, we miss the strategic risk of the 20-year horizon.
Yeah, that's, I mean, I will see. We see how it goes. The immediate challenge I think we face is that it's easier to talk about some things on a 20-year horizon. You know, I can talk about the course of America in a 20-year horizon, and that looks like it's just blue sky thinking. If I talk about the 5-year horizon, it looks like politics, right? So that will make the 5-year look, I think, trickier in some respects. 'Cause 20 years does insulate us a bit from being looked at as political. But cherry picking is always a problem. Yeah, the other president in the 2002 case is we all know from our work that how you ask the question goes a long way of what answer you get. And in that case, what happens is my intelligence predecessors kept getting the same question about connections between Saddam and terrorism. They kept giving the answer, same answer, no. But by asking the question over and over again, that had the effect of both of making it seem like it was more important than it probably was, and two, meant that intelligence was answering it yet again rather than something else, rather than maybe asking the question, why might Saddam Hussein not have weapons of mass destruction? Sir.
Ask you to put on a long-range hat and think of, if you think of the nation-state system today, that is engendered in some ways through the invention of the printing press and the written word that formed these imagined communities of nations, and now we just don't even think about it. We have the our own nation-states for the most part. The revolution in smartphones and internet, do you see any sense of new imaginations of communities that are right now, maybe at the very ground level, and not refracted on to the top, but are creating the tensions within states or between states. And they may not emerge formally for another 100 years, but the effects may be visible in 20 or 10.
I think there's a lot of interesting things going on there. People have talked now for 15 years or so about the market state. The observation that there are lots of people who are interested in being here for economic reasons, but not otherwise interested in being Americans. They just want to come here or have the opportunity to send their children here. What a friend of mine called the plutocratic insurgency. I probably won't use that in the global trend, but instead of people that don't want to take over the state, but just want to carve out for themselves a special place in that state, and how that was out of, as you say, from the bottom, we see the at least, obviously, the sort of nation-state system, artificial there, artificial in lots of places, breaking up. You ask the question, as you did, what are the 3 billion people who come online in the next 20 years? What are they going to have? What are they going to have? I don't know the answer to that question. My guess is, for them, a lot of our current concentration on privacy will seem quaint. Something they can't quite afford and don't quite understand anyway. But I don't know, that's just my guess. So yeah, I think you're right. There are lots of interesting things happening in the state. And even if you look at the European Union, right, for all the criticism I've made of it, as long as it's a tolerably solid economic unit, the Catalonians don't need Spain, and the Scotch don't need Britain. So lots of pressure. Logical, political, how that plays out will take a long time to play out, but we certainly have shadows in a 20-year time horizon, maybe some shadows in a 5-year time horizon. Sir?
You made various references to inequality, but it wasn't one of the things you cited as one of the 6 big things to worry about, but it appears that it's becoming an issue in a way that probably nobody much anticipated, like attitudes toward trade agreements. And I wonder, therefore, whether when you do these projections, you build in alternate possibilities, more scenario-like, where if public opinion turns seriously against trade agreements, for example, then the impact on a bunch of other things is likely to be substantial.
I think, as I said, one of the things I think about in the economic stagnation, structural change piece, is the increasing inequality. There, the challenge will be an underpinning for the debate. As you suggested, it has an effect on the debate on trade, even though it probably losers from the agreements, we know that, but it's also gainers, a lot of people that see themselves as losers, you know, hoping to gain a lot from trade agreements, a lot of good, so that's complicated, but as you say, it may be underpinning, even if slightly erroneous. I think in this season, where facts seem to matter not at all, rejecting a fact is probably a bad thing. That would be, I think, part of the debate. The real challenge with inequality is nobody really wants to do about it. The things that you can easily do about it are unacceptable politically, and the other things. It's a great policy challenge without a great toolkit back to address.
So how then do you handle that in the report?
Well, fortunately, in the report, we don't have to recommend ways to, we just have to try and foresee developments. So we will certainly make the point that among the things that will affect the politics, the disconnect between citizens and their states, is growing inequality. Lots of people out there obviously have expectations about what their state will be for them, but it isn't. It's informing, and that's part of that disconnect, I think.
Sorry. When you discuss the schism between the nations and the citizens, and I gather you made the presumption that this is getting worse than what it has been based on that.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's hard to, how would you judge that? It seems to be more visible, so maybe it's been going on. I mean, none of these things started yesterday. All of them have been going on in one form or another for some time. It's the precursors we might have seen. And I would have said the same thing, I guess, 5 years ago, but maybe now we can see it a little bit more pointedly.
But you're talking about on the international stage.
Yeah.
Are there examples of things where it's getting, where it's gotten much more dramatic in the U.S.? What about another, are there other examples you can?
I think it's pretty dramatic in Europe. It has somewhat different form and different roots. But it's pretty dramatic there. If you look at the huge turnaround in Germany, right, from the sort of euphoria of the first migrants to now, wondering whether Chancellor Merkel's going to make it or since I think by lots of their citizens, she for good reasons took on obligations that they have to discharge and can't, or won't, or don't want to. That's an example.
Okay,
if I may.
Yeah, sure. Take one more.
So you mentioned the domestic issues and one of the interesting developments that you mentioned with talking about the last 3 decades that you're asking is that the cost of education, specifically higher education, has risen exponentially, nowhere near commensurate with the average ratio of people in America. And it seems like it's exacerbating that gap that you mentioned between the haves and the have-nots, as it were. Do you think that the rising cost of higher education is having a detrimental effect to the American economy, and if so, what does that imply for our future as a country?
I think yes is the answer to all those questions. I think it is having a detrimental effect. You know, it's been interesting. We had this conversation 50 years ago. It seems to me you might have thought that technologies from television onward would increase productivity in the higher education sector. So far, not. The massive online courses that most of them bust. And so it's interesting that higher education has been pretty much immune to productivity increases, sadly. But I think it is, you know, the fact that it is increasingly expensive, and we see increasing at least anecdotes of people spending a lot of money, getting a lot of debt, and not getting much education out of it. That is a real problem. And if you look at
something from the Daily Texan.
Thank you.